attend.
You're in the room.
Accustomed as you are to public speaking.
I really am not.
I guess I'll come up here because I see that we're taping this matter. I think we'll go ahead and get started. I want to welcome you all. I really want to start by thanking Judge Moritz for volunteering to speak at our kind of inaugural Federal Bar Association CLE. So I'm pleased that you all are here. I want to start with just a few introductory comments. First about the FBA and then about Her Honor. And then we'll get to her presentation remarks when we have. Federal Bar Association has been in Kansas for 2 or 3 years, but with all due respect to my friend Arturo, I've said it's been sort of captive in the faculty lounge at the Katie Law School. Until about a year ago or so, I don't even see Arturo, is he in here? So I'm insulting him if he's not in the room. Until about a year ago or so, we've really rolled it forward. We've created a board, I have several board members here, we're starting a membership move. We're trying to pull ourselves into up onto the radar screen. Let people know that we're here. One of the things that we've done is, because of the nature of the practice in Kansas City, we've actually reconstituted ourselves, and I'm still learning this title, as the Federal Bar Association for the Districts of Kansas and the Western District of Missouri. There is no FBA in Missouri other than in St. Louis, so we've taken over the rest of the territory. To sort of reflect the way the practice goes around here as well. Because the FBA is not well known in this area, I want to make just a few introductory remarks about it before we turn it over to our presentation. And then I hope that you all will join us in a little reception in the atrium here in the courthouse after we're done, again, as a part of the launch for the Federal Bar Association. The mission statement of the Federal Bar Association is to strengthen the federal legal system and administration of justice by serving the interests and the needs of the federal practitioner, both public and private, the federal judiciary, and the public they serve. There are really about 17,000 members of the Federal Bar Association nationwide, so notwithstanding our newness in this area, it's a well-known and pretty well-organized association across the nation. That doesn't include the 12,000 law student members that we also have. There are 90 chapters, and the structure of the FBA is somewhat complicated. I won't review it because I'm still learning it myself. We have a number of chapters, divisions, and sections based on both practice area and on stage or term of your practice. That is to say, corporation, associate counsel, judiciary, senior lawyers, etc. I think it's interesting that although the FBA was initially structured to serve federal lawyers, which would be judges, you know, essentially federal agency counsel, assistant U.S. attorneys, and federal public defenders, today it's much broader than that. The judiciary is about 11%, almost all federal judges in the country are members of the Federal Bar Association. But we also have corporate associate counsel, federal service members, and others that are involved. The FBA puts out a federal lawyer magazine that is members that you receive, as well as your judicial director. That's a great assistance. I think I'll leave it at that. So I hope that you'll be hearing a lot more about the FBA. Two of the things that we're doing that you'll hear from us primarily in the immediate future are, and one of these you've already seen, we are organizing and hosting brown bag lunches in judges' chambers. About half of our judges in the District of Kansas have already done those. In the next week or two, you'll be getting an email about times and sign-ups for brown bag lunches for judges this fall. We'll do some more next spring. It's an opportunity for the judiciary and practitioners to have a fairly small, intimate setting to talk about areas of mutual interest in the practice of cases before federal court. We also hope to hold a couple of CLE seminars per year. We're in the planning stages of doing one on scientific evidence next spring. Again, as more of that comes, you'll be hearing more about that as well. Again, I appreciate you all being here for our launch of this Federal Bar Association, and I certainly appreciate my long friend, Judge Nancy Moritz, in being our speaker. I should tell you, Nancy and I have this joke that we tell each other back and forth. We met in law school, we were classmates, class of 85, Washington Law School. We're having our 30th reunion
which means, as far as I'm concerned, that I must have been 12 when I was in law school.
Somebody's
and
supposed to say,
seven.
You both look far too young for that.
It doesn't seem quite that long. But in law school, we were both on Law Journal, and she was my editor. So she was supervising my work. Fast forward about 20 years, and I become a U.S. attorney, and Nancy's an assistant U.S. attorney. And so then I was supervising her work. And now that she's on the 10th Circuit, of course, she will be, as I like to put it, affirming my work. I think that we've probably done the last swap in our relative positions with each other. But I was just thrilled beyond words when she was nominated and confirmed this position. Those of you like me who have known her for a long time know what not only a fine legal scholar she is, but just a very personable, down-to-earth person, and that's exactly what we want in our appellate courts. Nancy, of course, has had a distinguished career on the appellate bench. She was in the U.S. Attorney's Office, the appellate coordinator, primarily doing arguments before the court in which she now sits. She went from there to the Kansas Court of Appeals and then the Kansas Supreme Court. And now this is her third appellate court. There's only one more for you to get to.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that won't be happening.
You're right. So we are very delighted to have her as our speaker. And without any further introduction, you all know her, the Honorable Judge Nancy Moritz.
Despite being over the state court system for 10 years, and so when Eric called me and invited me a few months ago to do this, I was, of course, thrilled and happy to do it. And I'm happy that Eric involuntarily got himself elected president of the organization, because he'll make things happen, and he always does, wherever he goes, whatever he does. Eric always makes things happen, and he gets things done. And I say that because of our long history of being good friends, and sometimes colleagues, and sometimes in the boss. I hated that part, but it really worked. But truly, I did want to mention, Eric really was an excellent U.S. attorney, and James Brown and people sitting in this audience know that he did a tremendous job. I remember when we found out that Eric was going to be the U.S. attorney, I was the only one, maybe in all three offices, that had ever heard of him, because he was a tax attorney, and a very good one. But he'd been in federal court a lot, but not necessarily involved with the U.S. Attorney's Office. And I remember telling people, he's going to be great. Don't worry. And he was not only great, people still talk about him and have nothing but positive things to say about the work he did there. And I was lucky enough to get to be supervised by him as an appellate attorney, which you would think, he probably didn't have much to do with what was going on in the 10th Circuit those 4 years that he supervised me, or 3 years. He did, unlike other U.S. attorneys, probably past and since, because they got a whole lot going on. Eric managed to always know what was going on with me and with our attorneys who were arguing in the circuit. He knew what issues were being argued. He knew substantively what the law was in those areas. He would talk to us about what we might expect from argument and from the court. He argued several cases, at least a couple I remember when I was there, and probably more later, and did a very good job, some high-profile ones and some not high-profile. And he was just fantastic, and I just want you to know how unusual that was for a U.S. attorney anywhere in this country to be that involved in all aspects of the practice. He was also the same with the civil litigators. I was a civil litigator as well, and he had that same level of involvement then. So thank you, Eric, for that time and for the expertise that you gave all of us. I also want to thank John Simpson and Kate Marples, who are the two standing in the back that are law clerks. Kate, you're with Judge
Sebelius,
Magistrate Sebelius, and John is with Judge Malvern. And I think it's great that you're both involved already at this level, and that you've taken the time out of your, I'm sure, busy work to do this sort of thing. You may not realize it now, but it'll be a great thing for you in the future to have made these kind of contacts and to do this kind of work. You've got some materials that I put together myself, so don't, if there's too many errors, I don't want to know about it because I did have a clerk check this over, but I tend to like to put my own materials together. I still don't trust my clerks to do it. Eric offered his clerks, and it's not that I didn't trust him, but I just, you know, I trust my clerks to do my own work, but when it comes to presentations, I just kind of know what I want to focus on. So these materials, I may not even get to much today. I just kind of wanted to, if I don't get to them, except to touch on them, I just kind of wanted to put together some materials that with some, basically three kind of big issues that I think will touch upon probably everybody in this room's practice a little bit, and we may get back to that. I was thinking about what I wanted to talk to you all about today, and I know that maybe this may seem basic to some of you, but I want to talk to you about what I've learned in the last year of being on the court. I've only been there a year. I got sworn in here in this courtroom by Judge Melbourne a year ago in July. I had an informal swearing in, and I asked Judge Melbourne to do it. It was a very wonderful moment, and thank you, Judge Crabtree. I don't know if he's still in for your courtroom, but since then, I really had no idea what the 10th Circuit did behind the scenes. What did a judge do? What did their work involve? And knowing what I know now, I think it would have helped me as a practitioner to know how things work and what kind of things the judges are focusing on. And I'll try to give you a couple examples later as we go through about why I think it helps. So I'm going to give you some information that for some of you may seem basic, but I'm just going to throw it out there. You can yawn if you want. And anybody's welcome to ask questions through this. I hope to leave some time for questions of any sort. But if you have a question, raise your hand. I'm happy to answer it. I'd rather this be more interactive. But we all have residential chambers, in what we call residential chambers in our own home states, which some of you may not realize, but and I didn't necessarily realize that. We all have to maintain residential chambers. My chambers currently are in Lawrence on Mao Street. They're Judge Taha's former chambers. Great digs. We really ought to have, while I'm still there, we ought to have a brown bag lunch on my balcony. But Judge Taha lived in Lawrence, and her chambers were located in Lawrence. Chief Judge Briscoe lives in Lawrence, and her chambers are also located in downtown Lawrence in the building next to mine. Most of the judges, of course, are in their either in a federal building or in a state or in a federal courthouse. And I will be moving sometime probably within the next year right here to this building. My permanent chambers will be on this floor. James, I know you're going to get to see me every day. You're so excited. We probably won't see each other. You don't have to work. Is there still a cafeteria here? I don't even know. That was about the only time you saw anybody in this building, was downstairs. But so I'll be in what was formerly Judge Staple's chambers and are now the visiting judge's chambers. Plus, I'll have a part of the library. And the district court was gracious enough to give us some space that they weren't going to be needing. And in the next however many months, they'll be turning that into a circuit judge's chambers for me, which I'm really excited about. Each circuit judge has five positions to work with. I use those five positions. Judge Taha had two administrative assistants and three law clerks because she had, especially as chief judge, so many administrative responsibilities. I, on the other hand, have four law clerks and one administrative assistant. My administrative assistant is Susan Goodwin, who many of you may know. I met her my very first day as a research attorney at the Kansas Supreme Court 30 years ago. She was Justice Harold Hurd's administrative assistant, very young administrative assistant back then, and she was fantastic. And when I had the opportunity to hire her as my administrative assistant for the circuit, it was great. She's worked for Stan Haslett, the disciplinary administrator at the time, so she came over with me. I also have four law clerks. Tina Harden, who's a KU law grad, she was with me at the Kansas Court of Appeals, some of you know her, yeah, and the Kansas Supreme Court. And Lydia Krebs, a lot of you know her. I was lucky enough to get Lydia. She had 7 years as a Kansas appellate defender. and for whatever reason said she wanted to be a law clerk to a circuit judge, and I said yes, because I'd seen her work and I knew how good she was. And she's been tremendous. She just agreed to stay on with me. Actually, she's agreed to a third year, so she's starting her second year with me, but she'll be here with me at least 3 years. Federal law clerks can stay up to 4 years, if any of you know the system. Lydia's KU law grad. I also have Eric Turner, who was Judge Melvin's law clerk up until a week or so ago, and before that, so he has 2 years of federal district court experience, which I find incredibly valuable. And before that, he was with Judge Steve Lieben on the Kansas Appellate Court of Appeals, so I knew Eric then. And then I have Chris Dawson, who is a George Washington Law School grad, and he was formerly with a Kansas City patent firm. And he's K-State undergrad, and he's wanting this kind of experience for a year, so I've got him for a year. But as you can see, I tend to, is Brian here? Brian Clark. He was my law clerk until a couple weeks ago, and I had to let him go. Not for Brian was amazing. Brian worked for Judge Brattle for 3 years, and then for the Kansas Attorney General, and he wanted this experience too, and he had a year left that he could serve as a federal clerk, and so I was lucky enough to get Brian for a year, and it was wonderful, and we miss you, Brian, but he's now back with us, working for the Kansas Attorney General and Solicitor General, Steve McAllister, so that was a great experience. But I tend to try to get law clerks, as Arturo knows too, that have some kind of either life experience or practical experience, because it helps me a lot, and I think there's less of a training trend. So my colleagues, mostly, a lot of them at least, have all new law clerks each year, 1 year, 4 new law clerks. Sometimes they space them out and they start within a 2 week period, but they all start at a time. So I try to avoid that. What we do is, with our caseload, we have 5 dockets a year, and some of you know this, and I'm not going to repeat too many details, but you know that we have those dockets, but you really don't know what we're doing in between. And what we're doing in between those dockets is more than probably half of the caseload of the court. We have the dockets, and those are usually in Denver, and then we also have dockets in various locations. I've been to Albuquerque, and in the past year we've had dockets in Oklahoma City and Santa Fe, and we need to get a docket in Kansas again, so somebody here needs to see if we can do that somehow. The law school, we tend to like to go to law schools. We have a different panel every day, and we're on different panels. So for instance, in September, later this month, I have 4 days of arguments, 6 cases a day, 4 different panels, so that's 24 cases, 4 days, and then we go back and we conference those cases immediately after we, and start writing the opinions, and I'll get to that. And as far as how we prepare for that, I want to tell you a little bit about that, because this is where I think you need to know when you're writing your briefs, what the process is. And my law clerks, of course, are the first ones to see your briefs. Well, they see the briefs as soon as they come in. We just now are setting our docket for November. So next week or the week after, we'll get the briefs for November. My law clerks are finishing up my memos for September right now. And once we do that, I look at the cases and they look at the cases, and then Brian knows we've started a procedure where my law clerks kind of summarize the cases and kind of rate them. And then I assign those to my law clerks based on, try to give them sort of if it's 24 cases, they each get 6 or so, they're drafting memos. I've also started looking at some cases and saying, I don't need memos on these. I've been doing this long enough that there's 3 or 4 cases on a docket where I can say, you know, if I read the briefs and I do my notes right away on here, I don't really need a law clerk to give me a 10-page memo to say what I'm going to put in my notes, basically. So I've started saying no memo on some cases. And I know that several of our judges do that, especially after they've been around for a while. So all they're doing is looking at your briefs in some cases and then putting them aside and usually picking them back up again maybe a day or two before and looking at them again and making sure they know what the issues are. So, but in other cases, I'm asking my clerks for a memo. And I'm limiting my clerks to about 15 pages on my memos because I don't need 50 pages of memos, which is what I get if I don't seem to limit them. So I'm urging them to condense as much as they can, and in some cases, of course, require more than a 15-page memo, but mostly I'm asking them to condense your argument in your two sets of briefs to 15 pages so that once I've looked at the briefs and I look at their memo, I feel like I've really isolated it down to what I need to know for oral argument and for conference afterwards. And the reason it's so important for me, for everything to be so condensed and so tight in the briefs and in my memos, is because unlike every other court I've been on, we don't pre-assign cases on the circuit. So if I have 24 cases in September, which I do, I don't have any idea until we go to argument which of those cases that I'll be drafting the opinion on. And so at the Kansas Supreme Court, as many of you are aware, it's just the opposite in the Kansas Court of Appeals. You at least have an idea. You know when your clerks are preparing a memo and the cases that are assigned to you, and unless you end up on the dissenting side, you're writing that opinion and you know it. So you tend to prepare more extensively, and your clerk does on that case. And the other difference is my clerks at the Kansas Court of Appeals and the Kansas Supreme Court were sharing memos with the other judges, so they were having to write the memo for all the judges as opposed to just me. Now, my clerks, we do not share memos, which really bothered me at first because it seemed like a lot of extra work to me. So if I've got 24 cases assigned, I've got 24 memos unless I've directed them not to draft a memo. So, and nobody else sees those memos. So as a practitioner, you might be coming to the court thinking, you know, what in the heck? Why are all three judges sometimes taking a different focus? And I have seen that happen. And it could be because we all read the briefs differently and we all focus differently on the briefs, which we do often. But it can also be because our law clerks have discovered something different or have taken a different tact or have focused on a plain error argument as opposed to the merits and have kind of gotten us off in that direction. And I've seen that a lot on the circuit. And I have to be honest, I thought, wow, I don't know about this whole no assignment of cases, and it seems like a lot of extra work, but I have to admit, after a year of it, I think what you get as a practitioner are three judges who are much more prepared on every case, and maybe they're less prepared on some cases because they are, because you can't be, you can't just look at everything. But they're more prepared overall, and they also are often coming with viewpoints from their three different clerks too. And with no sharing, nobody knows what anybody's thinking ahead of time. So if you feel a little confused sometime about why judges are coming at you from different angles, that may be one reason, but in my mind, it's a good thing. I'd be interested to see if you all have had that impression. And that also means, though, and the other difficulty with this process that I've had to get used to is that means we don't get a case assigned until the day of conference. And I really wondered, how is this going to happen? And who's going to decide? Are we all going to go, I want that one, and everybody take the easy ones? Or no, it doesn't really work that way. The presiding judge, who's the most senior active judge, after we conference the cases, and we do it very quickly, unlike the Kansas Supreme Court, where we sometimes conference for days, we conference six cases usually within an hour or two. We don't go back to our chambers. Whoever the presiding judge is brings in some snacks. We work through lunch. We finish about 12. We just start right in, and whenever we get done, we get done. And if we're done at 1:30 or 2, that's pretty typical. But that also means that we're quickly deciding these cases. And I was a little uncomfortable at first because you don't necessarily know. You know, there's sometimes so many sub-issues and so many different ways to look at a single issue. For the most part, we don't have time to talk about that kind of stuff, so it sort of filters out with the judge that then gets assigned to write the case. It sort of filters down, and I have seen, and I think, Brian, you probably agree with me, that as you write the opinion, you sometimes have to say, well, I know we didn't talk about this at conference, but here's how I would resolve this issue, and there's some discussion back and forth as you go along, because the way we conference cases and move them so quickly, there's just no time for anything like that. The other kind of big area of responsibility that we have that I didn't realize when I was in the U.S. Attorney's Office is, I guess I knew some of my cases were coming back to me without argument when argument had been requested, and I didn't really know how the process worked. Well, we have Rule 34, what we call conference calendar cases, and we each have about four or five of those dockets per year, and they're usually in the off months. So if I have a docket in September in Denver, then in October I'll be working on conference calendar cases. And again, we have a panel of three judges. We all get the briefs, we all read the briefs, and then I work not with my own staff who's working on my term of court cases, I work with my folks in Denver. We have a large group of staff counsel, maybe 15 or so, Brian, is that sound about right, in Denver, and they get assigned to work with each of us on the every other month conference calendar cases. So after I review the briefs, I get on the phone with my assigned research attorney or staff attorney in Denver, and they all have great experience, and they also have expertise in various areas, which our clerks don't, and then talk with them, and after we decide how we're going to handle the case, we get a draft opinion from the attorney, and then I work with it back and forth. Everything's by email with 10th Circuit. We don't ever really see a person, which is a little different, but we work back and forth with them, and eventually we come up with a product, and it gets circulated to the other panel members, and it's treated just like a term of court opinion. Sometimes those end up published, mostly they don't. Sometimes they're lengthy, but usually they're between 10 and 15 pages. But those are all, the mechanics of that are all going all the time. It's all being very smoothly run by our folks in Denver. And then, while we've got term of court, we've got our conference calendar cases always going. We also sit on what we call screening panels, which I had no idea that we did this, and I'm finding it perhaps to be one of the most important things that we do as judges. And that those are panels, again, of three judges. For a year at a time, and I'm currently on a screening panel with Judge Hartz and Judge Timkovich. And we get opinions, usually on Thursdays, but not opinions, I'm sorry. We get emails with brief district court orders, it has all the briefs, we have everything we need basically to decide, and I'm sorry, I didn't preface this right. With the screening panels, the whole idea is to decide, once a case is briefed, the point of the screening panel is to decide what should we do with this case? What kind of attention does it require from us and our staff? Which I absolutely love, because we didn't have anything like this at the Kansas Court of Appeals or the Kansas Supreme Court. Cases just appeared on our oral argument docket, and cases just appeared on our summary calendar docket in the Court of Appeals, and I never had any idea as a judge why they were there, and I can't tell you the number of times I would have conversations with my fellow judges saying, why is this case on the oral argument docket, or why isn't this case that's causing us so much consternation, why did it get taken off the oral argument docket? But as judges, at least then, I don't know if they've changed their practices, as judges we didn't have any input on that, and it always seemed to me that we should be seeing the case from the very beginning and deciding what kind of staffing, what kind of effort it needed. And that's what our screening panels are designed to do. Every week, we get several cases assigned to each of us. And I look at everything. I look at the district court order, I look at the briefs, I look at we have jurisdictional memos, we have memos prepared sometimes by staff counsel. And I get to make that decision about what I think should happen with that case. Some cases go automatically to an oral argument docket, direct criminal appeals, unless there's a single sentencing issue, certain civil cases, but most every other case gets evaluated by a judge. And we decide, we have four options. We can send it to an oral argument calendar, we can say, yeah, this one needs argument. We can send it to we have a new category some of you may have experienced, which is a little different, but it actually works, which is We sent it to the oral argument calendar, but it's submitted on the briefs. And you may wonder, why am I getting sent to an oral argument calendar but no oral argument? It's because we think it needs something more than our conference calendar process that I just described to you. We think it needs work up by a judge and a judge's clerk, by all three judges and all three judges' clerks, as opposed to by one judge on the conference calendar and a staff attorney in Denver. So that's a new option that we have, that we actually have several cases every docket that are on that argument calendar and fully worked up, but there's no argument. And then the third option, of course, is we can screen a case to the conference calendar docket, thinking it could benefit from a memo from and the work of the staff attorney on it. Or the fourth option is, and this is mostly what happens with a lot of the certain types of cases, we keep those, what we call retained screeners, we keep them in-house. And we just, our law clerks draft, they get the files, they get the briefs, they get everything, they get the record. And within, in my office, usually within 2 to 3 weeks, my clerks have a draft opinion to me. I read everything again for the second time, and we circulate that opinion to the other members of my screening panel. And that actually keeps things moving better than anything. And a lot of those cases would be like a single issue criminal case, or only sentencing, or a certificate of appealability. There's all kinds of things that we retain in-house, and we just get it done with no memo or anything else. We just draft an opinion and circulate it. And sometimes, interestingly, sometimes those screening cases fairly frequently actually turn into something pretty significant and end up getting published, and so there's a little bit more judge involvement. But that's kind of, those are kind of all the, what I call the cogs in sort of our circuit machine. It was kind of overwhelming at first because all these cogs are kind of going at once, and you never actually see anybody and you never actually meet anybody because they're all in Denver and they're all sending you these emails and all these different kinds of cases. But I think after a year, I've kind of got a handle on it, Brian. I don't know, you might disagree. The other thing I didn't mention was there's another cog in the wheel, and that's a jurisdictional panel. We actually have random jurisdictional panels every single day. There's hardly a day I don't get at least one or two emails to a random panel. It's different every time, and I have to immediately look at those. Sometimes, I mean, we always try to look at them within 24 hours, but usually it's the same day. And we get all kinds of jurisdictional motions, and our folks in Denver work it up, but we get whatever briefing there is, whatever district court order there is. We look at it immediately, and we all vote by email immediately. So I know this probably all sounds kind of boring to you, but to me, it's really impressive because it's so efficient, and everything is moving all the time, and nothing just sits. And it, at least so far, I haven't had any motions or anything that I feel like, oh shoot, I forgot about that, or it's languishing, or this is happening, and I don't know what's happening. We constantly have all kinds of CMECF information generated to us that we can categorize any which way we want to check off and say, okay, is there anything I'm not aware of? And that's just, it's a good feeling from a judge standpoint. I think it'd be a good feeling from a practitioner standpoint to know that nothing's kind of getting lost in this large machine that is the Tenth Circuit. And with that background in mind, I do want to give you a few brief writing tips. And I hate to do this because I know most of you people. I know you're all incredible. So I don't really like to give brief writing tips. It seems to me it all sounds kind of pompous because just because I've been reading these things for 10 years doesn't mean I'm any better at it than you, and in most cases I'm sure I'm not. I have been, for the most part, really impressed at the Tenth Circuit with the quality of the briefs. I was impressed at the Kansas Supreme Court and Kansas Court of Appeals with the quality of the briefs. But there are always things that I think folks could do. And But I guess what I was trying to convey to you with the letting you know what all the cogs in the wheel are and how everything is moving all the time, how important conciseness is. Like you are, time is just of the essence. I remember hearing once when I was a practitioner, I can't remember which circuit judge it was, but I was in one of these presentations and I remember them saying, you better say it in the issue statement because I'm reading these briefs on the way out sometimes on the plane and this is what I'm doing and you better have a paragraph that says it all and I'll be right there because that's the time I have. Well, I don't feel like that. I don't feel that way because our process is so good in terms of vetting things before we get to on the plane to Denver. But I do feel like there could be a whole lot better effort at being concise. And I talked to my law clerks because we all agree, and I think Brian would agree, that we constantly are improving our writing. And the way that we are doing it is in a way I didn't really do it as a practitioner, which is they're giving me draft opinions, excuse me, and I am cutting them up and tearing them up and a little tip here, and I'm sure most of you do this. How many of you use track changes in Word? A few. It's the best thing I've ever done, and I wasn't resistant to it like I'm finding some people are, but in terms of improving the quality of my writing, it's been amazing because it's the easiest thing in the world, and you put on track changes and you can accept or reject, you can either accept all or none or one at a time of your colleagues or your law clerk's edits or your associate's edits. And the best thing about it for us is, as an opinion goes back and forth and back and forth and back and forth, which it does maybe 25 times between me and my law clerks, making it better each time, and sometimes three or four times in a day. This isn't like a long period, it's just that we go back and forth a lot. We put comments on the side, and they'll say, Judge, that change you made, I understand why you made it, but don't do that, because that screws up this, And they'll just put a little comment, and they'll say, better not, and I'll change it back. Or we just go back and forth, and I'll say to them, and I'm doing this at 10 o'clock at night sometimes, and that's the best part of it. My little comments are there, and I can say, I like what you inserted there case-wise, but I need a case that says this. Or I'll say, go back and look at the facts. I'm not going to do it. You go back and look at the record and tell me, does it say this? And so there's just so much of that. And we have found, and maybe it's just me and I'm saying this, but as attorneys, I think we've all found that we are all improving constantly on each other's work by just making comments on the side, making suggested edits, and either accepting or rejecting. And I realize that as practitioners, you don't necessarily have that kind of time. But my suggestion to you, if you can find the time, is after you have gone through that brief as many times as you possibly can, thinking as hard as you can about every single word. Is that word necessary? Is this sentence necessary? Did I just say this just kind of a different way 2 pages earlier? If so, don't say it again. That kind of stuff. After you've done that yourself and you're satisfied that you've excised everything you can to make it concise and that every sentence is as clear as you could make it and as simple and straightforward as you could make it, hand it to somebody. And it doesn't have to be another attorney. Hand it to somebody who you think is a good writer. And maybe sometimes, my clerks and I discuss this, I think it's almost better to have non-attorneys reading for style and to see if you have conveyed your point. Because if a non-attorney can say, this makes sense up to this point, but it doesn't make sense here, and they're not necessarily talking about the substantive issue because that may be beyond them, but they're talking about, have you conveyed it clearly? Let them hack away at your work. Let them say, you don't need this sentence, this is wordy, this sentence doesn't make sense, turn this around. Let them do it and get past your, if you have, just be humble and say thank you after they do it, because that's what I have to do with my law clerks. Thank you. thanks for slapping me around just a little bit more. And, you know, they're very nice when they tell me, yeah, this doesn't work, Judge, but they tell me. And that's one thing I ask my clerks when I interview them, can you do that? Can you constantly be saying to me, yeah, no, Judge, that's not quite right. Or you could say it better this way. And if you can't do that, I can't have you working for me because I need that. And they have to be able at the same time for me not to necessarily be always real complimentary, even though they're doing great work all the time. As Brian knows, I don't always say it. I just either accept or reject. Or I pick up something and say, every once in a while I might say, thanks, that was great. But the thing you'll find if you just give it to one other person, Dustin, just one other person. Do you do that? James is a good person. James Brown is the, for those of you who don't know James, sitting back there being quiet, he's the person who took my spot 11 years ago and has never left it in the U.S. Attorney's Office, and he's a fantastic writer. And so I know you probably do this, James, but just hand it to that other person and have them tear it up. And then say thank you and use what you want. And then if you really are feeling good, hand it to a second person and have them tear it up. And tell them to take it home that night and read it when they have time, you know. But just try to find the time. Try to give yourself a few extra hours or one extra day to let somebody else look at it. And that's the only real writing tip I have, because I think you're all really amazing writers for the most part. The word thing, and that may sound like a funny thing, you know, I'd be saying, do you use Word? But that's been one of my greatest irritations, I would have to say, at the Tenth Circuit is, I get there, and I've been on the Kansas Supreme Court. All seven judges, we circulated opinions we had on our S drive. When an opinion was ready, we all got it at the same time. We all made comments using track changes on the side. Sometimes it got a little crazy, but for the most part it worked. The author would then take it back, and you had this 10-day period to look over that judge's work. And nobody had seniority. I could look at it first, or the chief could look at it first. Well, I get to the circuit, and we don't really seem to use anything like that. We do circulate, of course. We circulate the opinion when it's ready to the other judges, but then they give any changes they have, even little nits and things, to their administrative assistant, or their clerk gives them to their administrative assistant, their administrative assistant gives them to my administrative assistant. My administrative assistant says to me, what can we make these little nit changes, or sometimes bigger changes? And to me, that seems like such a strange practice to use when we have all these capabilities electronically to make our edits quickly. But so, and I also found that a lot of the judges on the 10th Circuit don't even use Word, they use Word Perfect, and I was told that it's up to each judge to use whatever they want. I know, you say, that's crazy, right? But it's up to each individual judge, and that was something Brian knows. I didn't want somebody to tell me, it's up to you as an individual judge. When I first came there, I wanted them to say, this is how we do it. But I didn't get much of that. It's pretty much up to each judge. So I've had to really adjust how I tend to write using track changes and my comments on the side. I don't, for the most part, I don't give other judges those comments. I funnel them through. Or I send an email and I list my comments, so I'm kind of trying to work that in, but I do find it's been very effective for me to work with that to improve my writing. What time is it, Eric? 4:15? What time am I supposed to end?
4:30-ish. Whatever you want.
Let me say a little bit about it. Okay. Well, it's the end of the day. This is a tough time to be talking to people about boring things with me. Let me say just a little bit about what I put here, because in my written comments to you, and this first issue, I can't really get over how often it comes up, and that is this issue about whether an issue has been raised below, and if it has been raised, you know, have you properly asserted that it was raised? And if it hasn't been raised, even bigger, have you argued for plain error? And if you haven't argued for plain error, what does that mean? Does it mean it just goes away, you don't get to argue it, the issue, we just drop it sometimes? Or if you haven't argued for plain error and it wasn't raised below, and then the other side, your appellee, doesn't say, oh, hey, judges, they didn't argue that below, and they didn't argue for plain error, so you need to just consider the issue waived. If the appellee doesn't point that out sometimes, and I've cited the cases in here, we not only go ahead and look at the issue that wasn't raised and wasn't briefed as plain error, we sometimes apply an abuse of discretion standard. So you get a better standard of review sometimes in the Tenth Circuit if you don't raise an issue below, you don't argue plain error on appeal, and the opposing side doesn't say, hey judges, they didn't argue any of this, so you need to consider it waived. We do apply, which I didn't realize until recently in this Rota Law case that I cite here is where some of this came to light, that we have sort of this case law. So I guess my point was I didn't realize that you could actually strategize and maybe get a better standard of review if you don't argue, if you say, yeah, I didn't argue for plain error review and it wasn't raised below, but oh, hey, government, or whoever the appellee is, you didn't point out that I waived the waiver, so now I get a better standard of review. And that seems strange to me, but it is sometimes what we do. And I guess my point, when you look at these cases, and I've only cited a few of them, there's a number of them out there, is to just realize that I don't personally think it's a good idea to strategize like that. I think it's a good idea to follow our rule, and James knows that I was religious about this in the U.S. Attorney's Office. If the other side didn't follow this rule, which often people don't, which is 28.2C2, which says you have to cite the precise place in the record where each issue was raised below. I actually put a section in my brief, and everybody thought it looked kind of funny, but I said, you know, it was issue two, subheading A was, this is, you know, place where it was raised below, where this issue was raised below, even when I was the appellee, because that way, it reminded me to say to the judges, oh, they didn't do this, they didn't follow the rules, and oh, by the way, it wasn't raised below, and oh, by the way, that means plain error applies, and they lose. And you don't even need to consider it because they didn't go through the plain error analysis. Anyway, there's all these things that you can do to sort of trigger, but to me, that's the easiest one, which is in your brief formatting, include that, whether you're the appellant or the appellee, include that as a separate subsection under each issue. Was it raised? And if you're the appellee, put it in there if the appellant doesn't, because the court may very well, and we often do say, if you didn't raise it below and you didn't argue plain error, this is criminal and civil, then we're not even going to consider it. And that's the end of it. I mean, that is the end of the road for that issue. So it happens a lot, and it seems to be discretionary with the court how we handle it, and whether we consider a waiver or a waiver of the waiver. It's kind of up to the court, but I would not try to strategize this issue to get a better standard review. I would just make sure you always, as the appellant, if the issue wasn't raised below, and we all know that happens a lot, argue plain error and argue all four steps of the plain error standard. Don't leave any of them out because, again, if you drop the third or the fourth prong, we're going to say, oh, they argued plain error, but they didn't go far enough. And it just seems like that comes up in almost every case. So that's why I cited these cases here, not because it's all that complicated. I just want something that I think all practitioners should be aware of. The other couple issues that I thought were pretty universal that I've seen in the first issue, the first year, is one involving appeal waivers, which nobody but you folks on the criminal side care about this, but you're probably all aware of the Black case I cited on page 3, maybe not. James, I don't know, are you guys? Yeah. We had a big flurry after the Black case, and that was a panel last September right after I came that went right by the appeal waiver and went straight to the merits of an issue and said, we're not going to talk about whether the appeal waiver is enforceable because we're going to go straight to the merits. And then they found that there was no merit. Well, we immediately had a big bunch of cases with the argument being yeah, well, there's an appeal waiver, but we want you to go straight to the merits. And so then we had this, I don't remember which panel, but in Garcia Ramirez, which was this year, saying, yeah, no, we said we did this in black, but that's not going to be our, basically that doesn't signal any change in the court's case law on appeal waivers. We're still going to consider them first, and we're not going to reach the merits if you waive your appeal. So if you're familiar with black, you might want to read the follow-up in Garcia Ramirez, which kind of, I think, pretty well took care of what the court did in black. But we're still seeing it argued. And I put some notes in there about the Hahn steps and some inconsistency kind of in how we treated those. And then I added this bit about supervised release conditions, because that's been kind of the issue du jour on the criminal side lately. I don't know if you've seen that, Eric, and your Judge Melbourne in your courtroom, or Judge Crabtree. Oh, Martin's back there. He knows about this. Martin Ulrich, no. Well, I put in there, this was a case that I was on the panel, and this Judge Parks wrote this opinion, and Martinez-Torres, I think it was just, July 31st, so it just came out. He did something kind of unusual, and he opened the opinion with this paragraph that I have on page 4, and he wanted to do this. He wanted to direct it to prosecutors, defense counsel, and district judges, because got kind of heated in oral argument on this case, sort of people pointing fingers about why these supervised release conditions aren't being discussed, particularly in sex offender cases. They're very generalized conditions that the courts are just applying without much discussion, and very harsh in some cases. And so they're being raised a lot. And so this was what generated this opening, saying that we want everybody to start paying attention to this issue. Even though everybody's thinking about sentencing, it's very possible that the defendant will be released, and then if there are these conditions that are so restrictive and haven't been thought out, and they haven't objected at the trial court level, they may, you know, plain error may not save them later. And we want everyone to pay attention to these. We don't want you all to be using these form conditions, particularly in sex offender cases. They need to fit the defendant and fit the crime. And I'm generalizing very much, but I just wanted to put that in there for the judges who were here, the law clerks, because I know I've seen at least 3 cases in the last 6 months with these types of issues, and I know there's several more coming down the pike. So I think that's what Judge Parks was trying to do with that first paragraph, was just kind of say, pay attention. So that's why I inserted that there. I guess the only other thing I want to say before I can take a few questions, if we have time, is that I really appreciate this kind of group. And lots of people ask me, how did you end up on the 10th Circuit? And I always say the same thing. And Gary, you know, it's kind of crazy. And a lot of it is about being in the right place at the right time, because I really was. I was just sitting in my office the day I got a phone call from White House counsel, and I had no idea that they were considering me. Nobody believes this, but it's true. I was sitting there minding my own business. And it doesn't always work that way, as you all know. But it started out that way for me. But then it was almost two years of very long, very detailed, sometimes seemingly crazy process where you want to know, why do you need to know this about me? Why do these details seem important? It's your entire life kind of laid out to bear. But through all that, the thing that made me feel the best about myself was that I had been involved in organizations like this, statewide, all through my career, which has been 30 years this year, which seems hard to believe. And that turned out to be, I think, for me, the best thing I could have ever done in terms of my career advancing as it has, because I had worked with attorneys and good attorneys like yourselves. I'm looking at all of you going, wow, I mean, you're just tremendous. And I had worked with you, and I became a better attorney because of it, and I also made friends because of it, and I got involved. And so when I say thank you to these law clerks that put this stuff together, I mean it. I think this is the way to get where you want to go in your career, and to make some really good friends along the way, so that when you're in a position like I was to accept Governor Sebelius's appointment, or the president's appointment, or whatever it is that you're looking to be, you'll have this kind of support like I had statewide, because I had participated and I had actually, I'd written the articles and I'd done the presentations and I'd tried to do the work, at least for a while. Now, not so much, but I just want to commend you all for being part of this kind of organization and tell you that it meant a lot to me to be part of these kinds of groups too. And thank you, Eric. That's it. If anybody has questions, I'd love to answer them. Anybody?
Could you talk about oral argument a little bit?
Oh, sure. I guess that camera's there. I better not put it here. Oral argument at the Tenth Circuit is really, it's really no different than it was for me at any court. We all come into it without any conferencing. We don't pre-conference any case. And we didn't at the Supreme Court either. It just doesn't happen. So it's always kind of surprising to me where some of the other judges are at. And so I understand sometimes when I see quizzical looks on your faces, like, what are you focusing on this for? And it seems like that has been happening more lately. And I would caution you, I guess, to not convey that concern to the judges, because I have seen that done a few times at the Tenth Circuit where the attorney is just kind of, why are you focusing on this? Why don't we move on? Well, don't do that. You know, just think of a way to nicely say to me or whoever it is, well, Judge, I think you've misconstrued my argument, or I think you might be thinking of another case, which is entirely possible. But always be respectful, because I know it must be terribly hard, because we're not always respectful to you. But it seems like to me that that's one of the mistakes I see made the most, is that attorneys, particularly on the civil side, I don't mean to pick on civil attorneys, but I think that people like James Brown are up there so much, and the federal public defender folks like Carl, they've been up there, so they've seen it, they've seen people make mistakes. They may have made mistakes themselves like I did. But I think on the civil side, practitioners sometimes get an idea of what they think their case is about, and they do not want to let it go. I mean, I've seen them just literally shut the court down. We will ask a question three different ways that we all really want an answer to, and the attorney will just, well, no, he's going on his own way, and he doesn't care, he or she doesn't care where the court is going. You can't do that either. Because if we're all questioning you on something, we really want to know the answer. And so I would just say, always be prepared for a slew of questions, particularly at the Tenth Circuit, and I think that was true of the Kansas Supreme Court too. I mean, sometimes you don't ever get the chance to say two words of your prepared remarks. Sometimes you don't get your name out. And just think of that as a happy thing, because that's the best time you have, is when, if you're being questioned the whole time, even if you lose, I think it's good. I think you've done your job, and if you're prepared to answer those questions, even if you lose, you're doing your job. So I was thinking on the way here, one time I argued, and I was thinking, the reason I was thinking about this is because I was thinking, if I'd have known now if I'd have known then what I know now about how the Tenth Circuit works, I think I would have done some arguments differently. And one I'm thinking about is government, we used to have to take appeals we had to get them approved by the Solicitor General, and I'm sure that's still true, which meant you go all the way up a very, very long ladder. If the government wants to appeal, if Judge Melgren or Judge Crowe grants a suppression and the government says, yeah, no, that was wrong, we don't just get to appeal. Usually the assistant attorney would come in running in, we need to appeal, and I go, oh, it doesn't quite work that way. And then you start this long process of months of effort to get the Solicitor General to ultimately approve your appeal, or not, which happens frequently too. As Tony knows, probably never happened to him. My point is, I remember going up and arguing this one particular case, and I won't mention the judge, he's not here, and we had appealed a suppression order, and I was confident about this case. We had two cases, published cases, that seemed to indicate that this suppression was just dead on wrong. Get up there, I briefed it, and I'm the appellant, and I make my little speech, and one of the judges, won't name the name, he's still there, says to me, well, whatever my name was at the time, and I can't even remember. That's terrible. I know what you're thinking here. He says, Ms. Landis, that was my name. Why don't you have to get approval from the government before from the Solicitor General before you appeal this case? Didn't you have to get approval? I said, why, yes, Your Honor, we did. And I was kind of pleased because I thought, wow, he knows how hard it was to get this case here. And he said, why in the world did they ever give you approval to take this? Is a ridiculously stupid case. This judge was dead on, right? And I remember just kind of being flabbergasted because, honestly, to get that far, you really did have to have a pretty solid case. I was irritated, and I tried to explain, but boy, I might as well have sat down at that point because the other judges were gone in their head, like, what a big freaking waste of time this is. And I remember going home just thinking, what's the deal? It must have just been that panel. But looking back, I think I must have clearly failed to convey the real nut of that case, which there was a nut, and it was about these cases that were entirely inconsistent and the district court couldn't have gone the way he wanted it. He even expressed that he wasn't sure, and I must have truly failed to convey. I probably filed a 30-page brief when I should have filed a 5-page brief, and I should have said, here's what the issue is, and here's why the Solicitor General of the United States granted appeal, but I didn't. And somehow, I did not make my point, and those three judges came in there, and I think it was like 10 days later, I get an opinion. Still think about that, and of course, like all of you, I still think of every argument I ever had in front of the 10th Circuit, because I do, and think about how I could have done better, how I couldn't have, but now my perspective on it is, it wasn't just, oh, those judges just didn't get it, it's, what did I do wrong that I couldn't get them back on track, and why didn't my brief convey what it should have conveyed, and what they should have all come in there thinking? And I'm quite sure I'm guilty of filing briefs that weren't as to the point as they should have been. So, and sometimes it's just the judges. You know it, Tony. They just don't get it. So that was a really long answer to your question. You know, just be willing to go with the flow because it isn't ever quite what you expect it to be. At least that's my experience. And you're always hitting your hand on the side of your head. Yes, James.
Judge, I have a quick question on plain error review. And this is sort of something that's always been confusing to me. Let's say the appellant doesn't argue plain error review. The government points it out in reply brief. And then in his reply brief, the defendant argues
it. Right.
Is that waived or is that not waived?
Should be waived. In my book, it should be waived. But I've seen cases both ways, Brian. I think we have, haven't we? I know we had those where, of course, the appellant picks it up in the reply brief because, or they should. Sometimes they don't even do it there, but I would. I would pick it up there if I hadn't yet. Usually, I think the cases I've seen, we say that doesn't do it. And I've seen some pretty black and white cases recently saying we don't count that. So, but I know there's inconsistencies in that too. So. Probably worth a try if you're the appellant, but it's a whole lot better to raise it earlier, much better. And it's hard. It's hard to say, yeah, no, this didn't get raised below. It's nowhere. It's hard to say that, but you have to, or you just may have zero, nothing to argue at all. And you may want to stand up there, and that is another thing that happens a lot in oral argument, is you want to stand up there and spend a lot of time talking about an argument that wasn't raised below. And I've tell you what, you get cut off pretty quickly most of the time, which is, yep, go on to whatever your next argument is. So, tough. Any other questions? Everybody just wants to get to the reception, that's fine with me.
So with that waiver argument in mind, what happens if, say, you have a party that says, you know, district court, you should do this for reasons A, and the other party says, no, don't do that for reasons B. And the district court issues an order saying, you're both wrong, the answer is C.
Mm-hmm.
If that order gets appealed, how does the circuit law look at that regarding whether something's been waived?
Oh, I don't think there'd be a waiver there. I mean, as long as, and that comes up a lot too. The district court takes its own approach. As long as you made an argument, and I'm trying to think like the cases that would come up in suppression cases, I've never seen that. But I don't recall seeing us say, well, no, because the district court took a different approach, you can't now maintain whatever your argument was in the district court. I think we'd be pretty flexible on that. But that happens a lot too, because those district courts are creative. Oh, anything else? I also want to say that, you know, sometimes we aren't what we appear, because I remember a couple of the judges that were there when I was arguing 11 years ago that I just thought they were tougher than whatever, you know, and I thought they must just hate me. I get up to the circuit, they don't even know who I am. They don't remember me. Maybe because my name's changed twice and so on. Mostly they just don't remember me, and they're like, yeah, we were, and I'd say, you were mean, you were tough on me. We were not, and they're nothing like what they seem to be on the bench, or at least to me they seem to be, so I would say, you know, maybe, you know, just don't assume the worst about us, that's all. any other questions? Eric, anything we're done? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Judge Moritz. Now, please join us all for a little reception, a mingle in the atrium of the courthouse. I appreciate you being here.
CLE affidavits are right out on the table right here. If you want to fill them out and leave them in the stack, we will send them in for you.
Thank you. You know, I met you about 15 years ago.
You look really familiar. When did we meet?
Denver.
Yeah. Was there a case? What case was it?
We weren't opposite.
Okay. Yeah. You sure looked familiar. I kept looking
at
you thinking, how do I know
this guy? Yeah, we met out there in the hotel.
Okay.
Congratulations on your
spot. Thanks.
Yeah. The best part of my job is that oral argument.
Isn't it fun? Isn't it just great?
Yeah.
Say
what you want. Yeah.
Well, and it's just purely, I mean, it's like...
I call it my breaking bad.
It's like what?
It's what you went to law school for.
Oh, I know.
To make these kinds of arguments.
Have you ever argued in the Supreme Court?
No.
Which I give...
See, that's the only Mexican... No, no.
So well, I'll never get there.
By keeping the spurious argument.
Spurious. You might get there, yeah.
We were trying to get a kid with that judge.
Gorsuch.
Oh, isn't he something?
He's terrible. If I find one of his opinions, I read it.
Yeah, I've been on several panels with him, and it's
he's like
very
creative
compelling. Yeah, that's right. Mentioning Judge Gorsuch's opinions.
Oh, yeah.
He says he's quite
clear.
Right.
Yeah. It's great to meet you.
Nice to meet you. I'm a particle.
Yeah.
Just his writing.
Yeah, he's an excellent writer.
Yeah, he is.
Oh, yeah. It's very unique. We always say that.
Yeah.
We read his opinions.
We're really good.
Well, I know he has a second. Such a unique
stuff
style.
Stuff I cut out.
Right. You know. Well, and that's the stuff that he tells.
Yeah.
Oh, I'd love to say that.
Yeah, but I'm not going to say it. Right. Yeah. He's pretty good.
Thanks, John Shaw.
Nice to meet you, John.
It's an honor.
Nice to meet you.
Thanks for the plug for us. We'll break the surly bonds of Lawrence and come over here.
Yes, I'm hoping. Well, I'm serious about it. I think it might be a great place to have because I'm a horse. People could come and have a drink, which
we can't
see.
Yeah.
I'm only going to be here.
I keep telling people, less than 5% of our case is scrim or
civil.
Well, I can. You've got this major student chapter. And that's what we're helping these kids in law school. Is this anytime you have an opportunity to meet practitioners and judges when you're still in the job market?
Do it. Yeah.
And it's cheap.
Right. And they want to meet
Brian Clark.
Oh, we said he should be wearing a sandwich. I'm with Berkowitz, Oliver, William Shaw, and Eisenberg, Kansas City. Started out at the old Lathrop Coons Rider Club at Parker, North Dakota. Went to Brian Kelly.
That was expensive pain.
Oh, man. Britton Brown.
Yes,
wow. I'm so old, I still remember
it.
All that. The first firm that tried to launch into Kansas and got swept up.
Is that right?
That was the impetus for the Bennett Lytle firm.
Is that right?
Governor Bennett was with Spencer Fane. They tried to open a Johnson County office and got shut down. In a firm, and so he formed Bennett Lytle, which became one of the more famous firms in Johnson County. It was all because, and then along comes Morris and Hecker decades later, and they opened up Kansas. See, I'm so old, I remember.
Well, Charlie Schneider was expensive.
Okay, yeah, sure.
He was my mentor. He had been with what became Shamberg, Johnson County.
Who has moved from Johnson County?
I heard.
They're in our building. We were talking about that on the drive over about the Johnson County. And when they, I just like a sign of the apocalypse. And they moved from over by Winstead to Crown Center.
Yeah,
you're like, wait a minute, you know?
Well, for years it was important to be.
Oh, yeah.
I don't think it's such a big thing now.
Yeah, you could be anywhere. You could be in Rouen, France, you know, sending off a brief. And I appreciate your work on technology. I'm still in the Pleistocene myself, but all these new techniques.
Thanks to my law clerks, I'm not allowed. I have to.
No, you're great.
Well, I'm
different.
They're all ahead of me.
Well, the importance of it is an old literature guy, which I can't get out of my system. Is, I mean, it's about collaboration.
Yeah.
And to be able to do that.
Yeah. You just don't know until you start doing it how much better it is.
Well, thanks for doing this. And have you joined yet? Because one of the
I just told him,
one of the good things about FBA is that we have lawyers. Much more so. You know, we've got
you should get a photograph.
The U.S. Attorney's Office. Really something.